Gracious and almighty God, we thank you now. Thank you, God, for the privilege and the gift of growing old. Because, God, there are so many who have not experienced the gift. And somehow you've blessed us with another day's journey. Thank you. And God, we no longer function in the ignorance and foolishness of the youthful arrogant who somehow think they can do something all by themselves. By your grace and by your love. So God, I dare not stand behind this sacred desk and tell anybody what I'm going to do. But I will testify to what you can do. May everything that's done, may be every expression be an extension of your will, your way. And may you be glorified even as your saints are edified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I feel like going on. It is so wonderful to see so many of you that have blessed me throughout my life, and I've been able to share in multiple contexts. I see Mrs. Giles. I always got to acknowledge her as I remember her husband, the late B.S. Giles, who I consider one of my teachers and fathers in ministry. One of the great lessons you learn is that if you're going to grow old gracefully yourself, don't violate the elders in the midst right now. Come on. Can I just say this for a moment? We read, misread, it says, honor thy mother and thy father, that not their days, but your days, thy days. Why? If the generations don't see you honoring the mother and the father, how are they going to treat you when you get to where they are? You take care of the elders, because if you're blessed, that's where you're headed. And if you hadn't taught people to respect the elders, don't expect them to respect you when you get where they are. So I thank God for the witness as I grow older. Amen. Amen. I'm a twilighter. Come on, we all try to fake it sometimes. But come on, I'm past retirement age. The Lord's just keep blessing me. And amen. Because you got to realize something. Twilight can be at the end of the day or the dawning of the day. Oh. So I live dawning. Praise the Lord. The other day, as I faced the fact that I'm getting older, a few years back, I went to the doctor to get my annual physical. And he said, oh, Dr. Kinney, you've reached the golden age. So now I have to ask you these questions. Do you have trouble falling? Are you prone to fall? No. Do you sleep? You know, I got all these questions that I had to go through and be interviewed because I'd reached a certain point in my life. He said, well, how are you feeling? And I say, well, I'm going to be honest with you, Doc. Some days I don't feel as good as other days. And, you know, sometimes I got to strain to find my energy. And he said, well, welcome to the new normal. You got to be prepared for those days, but my job is just to keep you in the game. And I began to think about that, and I thought about how, in some ways, what he's saying was every day's not going to be where you feel your very best. But I always want to be able to say, I feel like going on. And I want to suggest that this text points to that in the life of the psalmist who is growing old
but wants to testify, I ain't through yet. I'm still here. I'm not denying that my hair's not gray. I'm not denying that I've grown older. I'm not denying that I can't do what I used to. I'm not denying that sometimes I'm feeble. But I am affirming that even in the midst of what you consider to be a negative, I ain't through yet, and I feel like going on. Come on, come on, come on. Now let's look at this text. And what you'll see in the text are the facts, the feelings, and the faith. The facts, the feelings, and the faith. The fact is that what the elder says is, I have been an example to many. It says, my hair is now gray. It says, I have now grown old. It says, but in all of that, I can look at my life and say, I have been an example to many. And many can still look at me and hear of the truth of God, and don't just hear my words, watch my footsteps, hear my testimony, learn what I've been through, see where I am in relation to where I could have been. And if I don't say a word, if you know my story, somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Look what it just said. I've lived long enough now to not be foolish enough to fail to recognize the twists and turns my life has been through. And where I am is not because I've been cute, because I've been good, or because I got my degree, or because of the money in my bank. Where I am is because of a grace of God, because I've been through some stuff that could have killed me. I've been through some stuff that should have knocked me down and kept me down. But right now, I'm standing here at this service telling somebody I'm still here and I feel like going on. Look. And he says, I'm an example. Now, you got to understand something. To be a perfect example, you're not a perfect person. See, some of us really think that every example has to be perfect. If you got a perfect example, you can't be an example because can't nobody follow you. See, you can be an example not by doing everything perfect, but helping somebody understand even when things have not been perfect and when you have not been perfect, you don't have to allow the imperfection to stop you from marching and keeping on. Guess what? Guess what I'm just trying to tell you? No, life for me ain't been no crystal stair. No, I have not been perfect. I've made my mistakes. I've been low and I've done some things out of order, but I'm standing here right now and tell you, I didn't pitch myself. Sent my steps in the outer order. I asked God to order my steps. And when you look at me, you got to see some scars. You got to see some blemishes. You got to be some wounds. And I ain't going to stand up here and act like I was so holy and perfect. And the reason I'm right here, I'm going to stand up here and tell you the Lord has brought me a mighty long way. And the same God that loved me and picked me up is the same God that will love you and pick you up. I'm going to be an example for you. I'm going to let you know that even when you're down, God can pick you up. Even when you mess up, God can fix you up. When you're out, he can bring you in. When there's no way, he can make a way out of no way. And I'll tell somebody. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, do you see it? Do you see it? Can somebody here acknowledge that you're an example, not because you're so holy, but you can be an example, not because you've been perfectly and right, but because somebody who's struggling and trying to make a way, you can tell them, hold on, huh? Stand in there. Don't give up. I can tell you what I've been through, where I've been, what it brought me through. And guess what? Don't look at my retirement account now. Let me tell you, when I didn't have two nickels to rub together, I didn't have a house to live in, but God kept me anyhow. Let me tell you, when I didn't have the clothes on my back, but somehow the Lord put food on my table, shoes on my feet, clothes on my back. And I'm not here to tell you how great I am. I'm here to tell you I serve a God who is able. Come on, do you see? What it says is I've been through something. Huh? And I'm an example because someone can see in my life how you make it through the struggle. No, come on, can I make it real plain? If you're a black person and you at retirement age, come on, that means, come on, and see, if you're at retirement age, if you're near retirement age, you go back and look. So that means you're going to be, I don't care whether you're 62, 65, they're raising to 67, as soon as it's going to be 70. The reality is that when you start looking back on your life, that means you got 70 years behind you, okay? Just take 2010, come on, 2002, come on, and 10, just use that as the figure, and go back 70 years. Come on, guess what you just told me? I know when you were born. Amen. Go back 70 years. Come on. Come on. And you going back to the 1940s. Amen. Guess what I just found out? You've been through World War II. You've been through the atomic age. You've been through the dropping of a bomb. You've been through depression. You've been through snarling dogs, hoses squirting at you. You've been through Negro, Negress. Come on. You've been through black. You've been through African American. You've been through black American. You've been nobody. You've still been on the other side for white only. Come on. Somebody in here knows what I'm talking about. You know what it is to be the last fire higher than the first fire. You know what it is to have to go through the back door. You know what it is when you didn't have a roof over your head and didn't have a pot nor a wind to help me, Holy Ghost. You know what it is to go through Vietnam. You know what it is to see your children die in war. You know what it is to see your children shot. You know what it is to see the markets collapse. You know what it is to folk the kids that you thought were changing not to change. You know what it is to go up the rough side of the mountain. You know what it is to sail through the storm, but somehow you're still here and you are an example to somebody. Guess what? I don't care what you're going through. I've already been down that road, and the Lord will. Come on, do you understand it? Mine is an example. And look what it says. I'm an example because God has been my defender. Look, read it. It does say I can be an example to you because I went to Virginia Union and I got a bachelor's of art and I graduated with honors. Amen. And I can remember President so-and-so, and we used to hobnob. Oh, yes, I'm here today because I had a distinct association with this person here. And do you know, I'm a member of the Lynx, and I'm a member of this, and I'm going to help me, Holy Ghost. And I belong to this fraternity, and I have this status. And you know, I live on this side of town. And you know, in the Westwood neighborhood, we're of a higher and distinctive quality, and we consider ourselves above those other folk who live in the other part. No, come on, y'all. When you tell it your story, you can't brag about what you got, who you know, or where you come from, because if you tell the truth, you gotta brag about I'm here because God has been my defender. And that's why I can't get too cute in what I did, because I recognize if it had not been for the Lord on my side. Come on. So look what it says. And it says, I'm going to be, guess what? While other folk are shutting up, I'm going to be an example of praise. Amen. Amen. Can I say this? I'm going to get in trouble. If you've been living long black in the United States of America and you can't praise God, you got to be crazy. I don't care what your title is and what your claim to fame is. And I don't need to tell you how to praise, because we praise differently. Not everybody's going to shout. Not everybody's going to do that. But somebody ought to know, guess what? I've been blessed by the Lord. Amen. Can I make it real plain? I'm never so cute, so educated, so cosmopolitan, so upwardly mobile, so wealthy, so intelligent that I can't let somebody know by the grace of God I stand here right now and know my personality is I tend to be passive and quiet, but every now and then I got to let somebody find out. When somebody asks me, how'd you get here? I can't just tell them what I did. I got to tell somebody. He's worthy of praise. He's worthy. Oh, praise. No. Come on. Can I stay here? You see, most of us grew up in a time, come on, y'all, let's be real, where we're taught, if you were going to be intelligent, you needed to diminish and deny your emotions. Come on. See, when I went to school, I was growing up. Now, you have to be a polished gentleman. And gentlemen don't raise their voices. Come on. Why? Because we were deceived into believing that any expression of emotion was demonstrative of your ignorance. Because intelligent people are cool, calm, collected, and are always like this. But emotional people are ignorant. Emotion is the function of the intellectually deprived and diminished. Come on. Passivity and quietude is the function of those who are truly educated and intelligent. And so you even came to church and you wanted to prove your intelligence and you would not even praise God. It's because, you know, it doesn't take all of that, and we're above that now. Come on now. But see, if you understand, if you're truly intelligent for years and people debate it now, you know, today we talk about the frontal lobe, the medulla oblongata, the limbic system and all of those things, even the reptilian brain. But for years we talked about bicameral consciousness. The left side of your brain controls the right side of your body and performs the logical, sequential, verbal, arithmetic and structured dimensions of your consciousness. The right controls the left and the more intuitive, feeling, spontaneous dimensions. Come on, the emotional dimension. Guess what? Guess what you just discovered? When you get so smart that you cannot express any emotion, you're not intelligent. You just lost half your mind. What am I trying to say? We can be an example. Why? Because in the midst of it, we don't hesitate to acknowledge God did this for me. The Lord has blessed me. Now I want to show you something. He said, this is the fact. I've come through a lot. This is the fact. I've praised God. But I got to confess, sometimes I feel like God is far away. See, come on, y'all. See, y'all know me well enough. See, I don't play. Trying to make this gospel something out there. The gospel lives right here. And if any of you all love God, and you're, as you grow older, there's going to be some times where you feel like, God, where are you? Some of you have been through grief, and you said, God, where are you? Some of you have watched your grandchildren mess up, and you say, God, where are you? Come on. Some of you have seen the children you raised and gave everything that you had to them. When you just needed a little time, they weren't there. God, where are you? Come on. No, come on, y'all. Can I make it real plain? What happens when you go to a church where you've given your last dime, your nickel, your service, your time, and everything else, and now that church says, we only want young people? When you've been serving God, but it feels like the folk who ought to be encouraging and you supporting you are walking you in abandoning. Because guess what he says? I feel like these people trying to hurt me. Now, come on, guess what? You got to be wise as you grow old, because there are some slick, slimy folk, even in the church, who are trying to use you to get something from you, and not because they care about you. Sometimes it even feels like, where you go? Come on, can we make it real plain? Every psychologist will tell us that one of the aspects of growing old is a danger of depression. And depression is not a sin. Come on, y'all. Everybody in the Bible who loved God went through moments where they got low. Come on. And if you never get low, then you must not have a marvelous relationship with God. Because the reason you get low is because there appears to be incongruence in the world between what you expect of the God you serve and the world you got to live in. No, y'all, come on. See, sometimes when I see what's going on in this world, when I see a Ferguson, Missouri, and I can see a child now, I don't care. Now, look, now, don't get wrong. Guess what? See, don't misunderstand this. I don't care what he did. He's still my child. And you don't just shoot my children down. I don't care whether they're in Florida, North Carolina, New York City, or Ferguson, Missouri. Do you understand? Or Richmond, Virginia. Come on. See, sometimes I get concerned about the miseducation of our children. While you can build more prisons while you run and test the show, if they do not have the reading scores by the third grade that you can project that they'll be in prison, and you will devote billions to a prison, but you won't build new schools. And no, help me, Holy Ghost. See, what I'm trying to say, some of this stuff ought to get you down sometime. And he says, guess what? I get down. And we do live in a youth culture. Huh? Come on. But what every test will show you, when you exclude the elders, the character and the quality of life diminishes. Come on. And I always try to tell young pastors, okay, you're kicking all the elders to the curb. If you are blessed, you're going to become one. And guess what you just told the people you are teaching in your church? Put me out. Y'all didn't hear me. You are just teaching the people to put me out because I've never taught you how to glorify the gift of the elders that God gives you. And it says, guess what, yo, I feel. Sometimes, as an elder, I feel unappreciated. Sometimes I feel like folk even want to do me harm. And God, I need to tell you this. Sometimes I don't feel like you're very close. Now, wait a minute. I'm an example, but I still got feelings. And I feel this way sometimes, God. And I could wish I could say growing old, if you love God when you grow old, you'll never feel like God is far away. Can I make it real plain for you? If Jesus had to cry out, my God, why do you think you get a pass on your life? And you got to understand this. The deeper you love God, the more vulnerable you are to moments of feeling down. Why? The deeper you love God, the more your sense of purpose, vision, and direction is defined by the relationship with God. And anytime you experience something in life that does violates that relationship, it can get you. You've never asked, how can church people act like this? That's that moment in the midst of the fact of your fidelity, you still have feelings. And part of growing old is knowing how to negotiate the feelings. Come on. And I'm through. Look at this. Look how he responds to what he's feeling. He says, God, even though I'm feeling all of this, I will put my hope in you. God, I will preach and proclaim about you. Guess what he just said? Even though some days I feel down and I feel feeble, my feebleness can't stop me from praising the Lord. Come on, how I'm feeling can't stop me. Have any of y'all ever been blessed by somebody who's flat on their back? Come on, and sometimes ready to transition from time to eternity, and you go to see them, you trying to lift them, but flat on their back, they give you a testimony that will lift you because they still got it. Come on, can I tell you something? I don't care how you feel. Your feelings can't stop you from praying. I don't care how you feel. Your feelings can't stop you from praising. And what he says is, God, I don't matter what I feel, I'm going to praise you. Because I'm walking and relating to you in faith, God. And my faith looks up to you in spite of a situation. Come on, can I use my little thing that I always say to the young people? Can I say it to the elders? You can never allow your situation and your location to be the basis of your identification and place a limitation on your inspiration. Because your situation and your location is not the source of your identification. Because your identification is in your creation, not your situation and your location. And if you can claim a relation with the source of your creation, there is no limit, no situation or location that can place a limitation on your inspiration, your elevation, or your destination. Guess what? You ain't seen nothing. I feel like like going on. Tired, but I feel like going on. Disappointed sometimes, but I feel like going on. Hurting, but I feel like going on. Because I meet my feelings with my faith. By faith, we understand how the world was framed. By faith, Noah sailed through a rain of 40 days and 40 nights. By faith, Abraham sojourned to a land of promise. By faith, Sarah conceived at a late age. By faith, Huldah interpreted the law. By faith, Deborah judged the nation. By faith, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. By faith, Moses crossed the Red Sea. By faith, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked out of a fiery furnace. By faith, Daniel came out of the lion's den. By faith, David slew Goliath. By faith, Elijah called down fire on Mount Carmel. By faith, Paul and Silas walked out of a prison at midnight. By faith, Jesus got up early one morning with all power in his hand. By faith, I got out my bed this morning. By faith, I preached this sermon. By faith, I'll make it another day. We've come this far by faith, and he never failed me yet. And I don't know about you, but I feel like going on. I feel like going on.
Would you please stand? Feel like going on. Feel like going on.